Good evening, folks. Higher Chemistry 2022. A few people have asked me if I could put this up. I think I should probably warn you and say that sometimes autopsies on recent exams can be potentially more negative than positive, so feel free to not watch this if you don't want to. Just wait until August, see how you got on. Okay, if you're still watching, okie dokie, glutton for punishment, let's have a look through this. An element contains covalent bonding and London dispersion forces. The element could be. It's not a great question, actually, to open with. It should have been phrased, when you boil or melt the element, you're breaking covalent bonding or breaking London. It's not a great question. Let's have a look. We can throw out the metal, first of all. Sodium's out. Boron, neon, if it contains covalent bonding, neon is out. London dispersion forces are classically said as being between molecules, intermolecular. Boron has no molecules. The whole thing is one big giant network. So the answer is D, sulfur. If you're already thinking, oh no, perhaps now's the time to stop. Number two, relative quantities of energy equivalent to successive... What? The graph below shows the relative quantities of energy equivalent to successive ionization energy for an element. It just shows the ionization energies. You spanners. Why did you phrase it like that? Right, okay. So we see the first two are low and there's a big jump to the third one. That implies that you're cutting into the next layer of electrons here. So there are one, two electrons in the outer layer, which means I'm going to go in the most stable charge. It would form a 2+ ion. Sorry, but this is slightly clumsy. I've zoomed in so you can see the questions, but it means I have to move it around a bit. Sorry, lots of rustling at this time of night. Hydrochloric acid has a higher boiling point than just hydrogen because, well, HCl is polar, hydrogen is non-polar. Classic, the polar covalent bonds are stronger. You're not breaking the covalent bonds. The van der Waals forces in HCl are stronger. Yeah, that sounds right. Hold on. They mentioned covalent bonds again. No, you're not breaking bonds. C. Number four, are we on camera? Which line in the table best describes elements that act as reducing agents? Oh, God. Reducing agents get oxidized themselves, so therefore they will lose electrons, so we can throw that and that out. And reducing agents are... Again, without cheating and going to look at my data book, electronegative... Oh, of, wait a minute, of course. Now, high electronegativity things are down the bottom of the table. And they are oxidization, so therefore it's going to be low electronegativity. Reducing agents. So we're going to go with... B. Just double check that in my brain. Things that have a high electronegativity are things like fluorine gas. They do not get oxidized. Good luck trying to oxidize fluorine. I'm going to go with B. Five, the correct redox equivalent for the reaction. Oh, I'm going to use a data book for this. What I'm going to have to do, basically, is find the iron 2. I also need my specs. Excuse me, I'm getting old. Okay, just went and checked the data book. Dichromate involves, it's an oxidizing agent. So it itself gets reduced and it gains 6 electrons, which means if you have a look at this, iron 2, going to iron 3. So I think, yeah, iron 2 going to iron 3. So what you're going to have to do is you're going to have to, iron 2 going to iron 3 is losing 1 electron. And because there's 6 electrons involved for every 1 dichromate, you're going to have 6 irons going for every 1 dichromate. So that's why that one. Can't be this one because if you notice here, iron is 2+ is going to iron 0. So that would involve a change of 2 electrons. So that would only be 3 there. It's the iron electron equation, combining them. You've got to make sure the electrons are the same number as each other. Number 6, the famous mixtures here, magnesium bromide. They always use magnesium bromide, magnesium sulfate. I was discussing this with just one of the hires just the other day. So 3 moles of magnesium ions, that does not help us because we don't know the relative ratios of these, but we do know 4 moles. This is a recycled question. I could have sworn I've done this question just a couple of days back. I don't teach higher this year, but I was helping somebody else with it. Anyway, 4 moles of bromides means that this number here has to be 2, because 2 times 2 is 4. So therefore, there's 2 magnesium ions from here, 2 moles of magnesium ions, and we've got 3 moles of magnesium in total, so therefore that must be 1 there. 2 plus 1 gives you 3 magnesiums. How many moles of sulfate? Well, there's 1 magnesium, 1 sulfate, so therefore there's 1 sulfate ion. That is definitely recycled. Number 7, name the ester time. The correct name for this ester is Bob. No, what we got? We've got 1, 2, 3, so that's propyl, which means we can throw that out. The reason I know that's the alcohol is because that was the carboxylic acid. So it's propyl. Oh, I nearly forgot to count that carbon. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, look. Classic SQA trick. Propyl butanoate is before propyl pentanoate. So if you forget, if you just count the 4 carbons, you'll go with that one. The answer is D. Number 8. Can we see this on the camera okay? Hopefully you can. Structural formula for this compound is shown. Which of the following is not an isomer? Oh boy, this is donkey work time. Interestingly, the person whose paper I've got from Melbourne has done exactly what I would do as well. Add up the carbons, the hydrogens, the oxygens, and then... Is there a shortcut here? I think you could probably go with the number of carbons, I'll bet. One of these doesn't have their... There's no point in watching me do this. I'll just pause this video. Wait, maybe there is a shortcut for this one. This is basically an alcohol that's lost 2 hydrogens. And alcohols are CnH2n plus 2O, effectively. Normally 2n plus 1OH. So we're looking for that. CnH2nO. I've just realised there is a shortcut. Because we're looking for not an isomer. I nearly made my classic mistake, which means 2-ethylhexan-1-ol must be the answer. So there was a shortcut for that one. Saves me having to do too much waste of time donkey work. Number 9, are we on screen? Yes, we are. Never heard of it. Medicine that can be used to treat nerve pain. Which line in the table shows the 2 functional groups present in this compound? Again, this person has circled these functional groups, which is nice. Hopefully they've got the right answer. That is the amine group. And that is the carboxyl group. So that's a nice, easy one for a change. Number 10. Number 10 is on the screen. Prenol. Again, never heard of it. Compound that occurs naturally in citrus fruits. Okay. Double bond and an OH. Which line in the table correctly describes the reaction of prenol with bromine solution? Well, it's going to decolonize bromine solution. So we're talking about these are out. This person scored them out as well. And copper 2 oxide is going to react with that and oxidize it, so therefore you're going to make copper, which is your brown solid. Number 11, the iodine number of an oil. Oh, this is an old one too. If you're as old as I am, you get to recognize some of these from a long time ago, as in the old higher. Problem solving, never heard of the iodine number. It's the mass of iodine that will react with 100 grams of oil. And as a measure of the degree of unsaturation, that is very true, because the more double bonds, the more iodine that can react. Olive oil has an iodine number of 84, and palm oil has an iodine number of 48. Because you're just adding the iodine, you're cracking open the double bond, it's addition reactions, by the way. That's why the more double bonds you have, the greater the mass of iodine that can react. Maybe they should have explained that? Maybe not. Tough one, though. So, palm oil is less, which means palm oil is more saturated. So that means these two are out. And if it's more saturated, it will have a higher melting point than olive oil, which is B. Number 12. I'm hoping you're not feeling too hopeless by now, by the way. There's a decent chance, guys, you can't remember what you put anyway for these. Number 12... Wow, okay, this is a soapless detergent molecule. Here's our big long nonpolar bit, there's our ionic bit. Which line in the describes a step in the cleansing action of a soapless detergent? Well, the head is hydrophilic, it likes water, and it dissolves in the water. And the tail dissolves in the oil. So I'm looking at B. Is it as easy as that? Hydrophobic is wrong, dissolves in water. Hydrophobic dissolve. Hydrophilic. No, that's good. Okay. Not as complex as it looks. Almost like a distractor here. You just have to know how soaps work. Which of the following is a secondary alcohol? Well, butan-1-ol is not. So again, this person scored out, which is nice. 2-methylbutan-2-ol looks like it should be. Butan-1-ol, nope. Albutan-2-ol. Ah, that's because the methyl is on the same carbon as the hydroxyl. That's a tertiary alcohol. So it's D. Number 14. The compounds below are examples of flavour molecules found in some plants. Cucumber, blah, blah, blah. Skip the oil. Skip the question. Which line in the table shows the solubilities of these compounds in water and in oil? Right, solubility is based on the presence of hydroxyl groups, which makes it more likely to be soluble in water. So I'm seeing a hydroxyl group here for vanilla, and a couple of hydroxyls, 3 hydroxyls, for ginger. So and these ones have none. That looks like a terpene, doesn't it? And that has no OH. I'm going to say vanilla and ginger are soluble in water. So I'm going to go with C. Again, wasn't as much work as it looked, that one. A oxidation of this compound. There is that is a secondary alcohol, which means you're going to create a ketone. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 ketone is going to be on there, and you're going to have a branch on there. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it's a pentan-2-one. Don't need to go any further. It's that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 4-methyl. Just double checking. Number 16. Which of the following describes how to fill a burette with acid and take the initial reading in a titration? Rinse the burette with acid. Fill above the scale with acid, drain some of the acid, and read from the top of the meniscus. This person has discarded that. Wonder why, because that looks about right to me. Going to go with a hesitant one on that. Let's check the rest. Rinse the burette with deionized water. No. Then you dilute the acid. Rinse the burette with acid. Fill above the scale with acid, drain some of the acid, and read from the... Oh, the top of the meniscus. Ha ha! This person was a stage ahead of me. The bottom of the meniscus. Excellent. Number 17. Wow. Big long molecule. Lycopene. Very similar molecule. Beta-carotene. Tomato juice contains a mixture of terpenes, including these two. Terpenes can be separated using chromatography. Which is the most suitable solvent to separate lycopene and beta-carotene? Well, for chromatography, the molecules you're separating have to both dissolve in the solvent. So on that basis, these are huge, big, long, non-polar molecules. The only one of these four that is a non-polar solvent that would dissolve both of them is pentane. I'm going to go with that one. It's a strange question. Number 18. The graph shows how the reaction rate varies. Right, going to pause for this. There's no point in watching me mull this over in my head. I'll read the graph and I'll come back with the answer. Okay, and according to my calculator, the answer is 250 seconds. 0.6 look along, you come to that, flip it over, you get the time, the reaction time. There's nothing that I'm missing there, is there? No, it's all seconds, there's nothing nasty with the units or anything. All good. Number 19. Butene reacts with oxygen as shown in 100 centimetres, 6 to 1 ratio, okay. 100 centimetres cubed of butene was reacted with excess oxygen. Compared with the total volume of gases before the reaction. Oh, this is an interesting twist. Normally, they would ask for the final total volume. Now they're looking for the relative difference between the volumes before and after. That's quite a sneaky one. It's not necessarily a bad question, but they're running out of ways of asking these questions, of course, guys, which is why they have to bend them like this every so often. So we started. Wait a minute. Excess oxygen. So you don't actually know the total beforehand. That's just excess. Some thinking required. Let me pause while I think. Okay, thinking done. I was overthinking this. Let me show you my scribbles here. I was worried about the fact we didn't know what the total volume of oxygen was, but it turns out you don't need it, because if you have a look at it this way, it's 1 to 6 to 4 to 4, because that's a gas, so we have to include the water. So the total reaction beforehand would have been 700, and after 800, so therefore it's 100 centimetres cubed more. That was easier than I thought. I was overthinking that one. It's quite sneaky, quite like that. Not easy, but I quite like it. Number 20. Equilibrium, following solutions would favour the forward reaction. We want to drive this reaction this way, which means we need to add some of this. But of course, none of these are this. That's okay. Standard SQA format. If we can't add to this side, we will remove from this side. And the best way of removing it, there's two ways of doing this. I see hydrogen ions there. That looks like a culprit, because if you add a hydroxide ion, then these will get snatched out of the equilibrium and you'll drive the reaction to the right. So the answer is sodium hydroxide. Must be 25 questions in this. Yeah, 25. Okay, number 21. We're nearly there, guys. Some energy values associated with the chemical derivative. So the enthalpy of reactants is 30. The activation energy is 110 for the forward reaction, and the activation energy of the reverse reactions is 70. Okay. Which of the following diagrams shows the potential energy diagram? Are we all on screen? Yeah, we are. So we all start at 30. Enthalpy of reactants was 30. That does not help us. They're all 30. But the activation energy of the forward reaction is 110, which means we need to go up to 140. Oh, that's easy, actually. It's just that one. Can we check? Is there any way to check that? If we're ending about 70. 60, 70, so... Yeah, that would be 70 as well for the reverse reaction. If we go from 70 to 140, yeah, it's D. That was a lot easier than I thought. These are odd questions. They've sort of got me overthinking some of them. It's interesting. Consider the reaction pathway shown below. According to Hess's law, the delta H value. This is ringing a bell from like 15 years ago as well. In fact, I recognise these numbers. They've not even changed the numbers. I'd love to go back and see if I could find that. See if I prove if I'm rambling, which I frequently do, or not. Anyway, moving on. We're going from Z to Y. So we want to go from there to there, which means we've got to go around the houses round this way, which means this needs to be changed to positive 210. This stays as negative 50. And this stays as negative 86. Should do that in my head, but it's late at night. So therefore, 210 minus 50 minus 86 gives us plus 74. 23 and 24, are we on screen? Yes, 23. 50 mils of 0.1 molar ammonia was popped into a 250 ml flask and topped up with deionized water. Right, we started with 50 and we have diluted it by a factor of 5. So we've divided the concentration by 5, so therefore it's just going to be 0.02, which is that one. 24, an experiment involves reacting 0.02 moles of silver ions with ions of A, group 7 element, to form a certain amount of precipitate. Which of the following is the precipitate? Well, going to need a data book for this, guys. Let me pause. I was just about to do a load of donkey work, which isn't necessary, and the person that answered this question has actually beaten me to it. This is an unusual one, which is mass moles and GFM. In this case, you're actually solving for GFM. Because silver 1 ions means that you'll have 0.02 moles of the whole compound if you have 0.02 moles of silver. So if we solve for the GFM, then subtract the mass of silver, you're left with just the mass of your group 7 element. Let me go and do that for you. Yes, somebody in Melbourne deserves a gold star for thinking. 143 take away 108 gives us 35.4 left over. That, of course, is the GFM of a chloride ion. 24, last one. 25. Titration experiments carried to determine the concentration of vitamin C in orange juice. A sample of the orange juice solution was pipetted into a flask and 10 centimeters cubed of water was added. Starch was thrown in, titrated with iodine. Which line in the table shows the most appropriate apparatus to use when carrying out this procedure? To add the water. Water. 10 centimeters cubed of water was added. So that's just dilution. This is a really nasty practical question. So that's just literally just diluting it so you can see the colour change easier. So that is not crucial. It's also not 10.0 or anything like that. So, we could use any of them, really. Measuring cylinder, probably. Beaker's pretty sucky. So I think we're throwing out, this person's also a nurse, he's thrown out beakers. So, measuring cylinder and flask? As in the flask in the bottom, that's always supposed to be a conical flask. In theory, I'm guilty of drawing that as a beaker in some of my diagrams. It's supposed to be a conical flask, so I'm going to go with A. If this has been useful, you might want to let me know, and I could maybe do the written paper as well. That's going to be a bit of a slog from your point of view as a watcher, though. So if you're not interested, you know, just tell me not to bother. It's up to you. It's your call, guys. Thanks for listening, and have a good night. Bye-bye.